This is episode 107 of the Reading Cove Book Club's podcast. If you're a book lover who may be interested in joining an online book club, please visit our website at thereadingcove.com to learn more about our group. For October 2019, we're discussing The Fire Child by S.K. Tremayne. So hi, I'm Millenia, back in Florida.
And I'm Roberta, still in Georgia.
And Roberta and I are two members of the Reading Cove Book Club, and we're here to talk about our 227th Cove pick, The Fire Child by S.K. Tremayne, which was chosen by Cove member Mary over in Scotland. So what did you think of The Fire Child? I liked it.
I liked it. Yeah, I mean, it sort of reminded me a lot of these gothic stories that were really popular back in the late 60s and early 70s. You know, there was always this big, dark, brooding estate or whatever.
Like Rebecca.
And yeah, like Rebecca. Well, that was even further back. And then there was the shadow of the first wife and also and mystery surroundings. But it was a good story in its own. It was a sort of more modern thing, but and with it being there at Cornwall, when it was sort of like more isolated and more in a rough area, not your typical garden type place you might find other places in England, it gave it a certain atmosphere. So yeah. I really liked that part of it too.
Yes, I definitely felt this mysterious, sometimes creepy, isolated atmosphere, you know, of Cornwall and the cliffs and the shafts and the mines. It was really creepy. I was like, why would anybody live out here?
I don't know. Because there was money to be made at one time.
That's right.
With the tin mining and other stuff. But other than that, it seemed like it was pretty isolated from the everyday other areas.
Exactly. Yeah, more populated areas, I guess. So Rachel, the story is told from Rachel and David's point of view. So I was happy about that and that it wasn't just Rachel. But I think Rachel at first was, you know, she came across as very insecure and like she was so happy that she caught a wealthy and attractive husband. So at first it was like, I saw some self-esteem issues and I kind of was wondering, okay, where's the conflict going to arise? Is it going to be with David's mom? And then when David was like painting her and making her look like his dead wife, I thought, okay, it's going to be all about her not measuring up to his dead wife. But it didn't really go in that direction.
No.
Which I was happy about. Because that seemed kind of cliche, right?
Right.
Like it's been done before. But the twist that I thought it was really interesting and it didn't really go the way I thought it was going to go either was when it's revealed much later in the story that she had these mental issues in the past. She'd had these postpartum psychosis issues and she'd been hallucinating and got estranged from her family.
Right.
And then I thought, that means, like I said in the group, because we've already started discussing it with the other group members online, I said her whole POV, it threw it into question. Like everything she had been telling us, I thought, oh, maybe none of that was really happening. Maybe she's just been hallucinating all of this.
Right, yeah.
But that wasn't the case. I think it would have been better, and like Faith and Jolene in the group were saying, yeah, that would have been really good if she'd become an unreliable narrator at that point.
But I still like the other twist that it made it really, you know, different and worthwhile.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I thought that when David got physical with her, I felt like, whoa, where did that come from? It's like it gave me whiplash. He was mysterious. We knew he was hiding something that he had talked to one of his friends about and the friend had passed away. And he felt like there wasn't really anybody else he could confide in about what really happened to Nina. But I didn't see him as a violent man.
No.
So that just kind of came out of nowhere. And I thought, maybe it didn't happen. Maybe she hallucinated it. But no, it did happen.
No, he really did.
Yeah, so that was weird. And then he gets banished from the house because she tells a lie that he knew she was pregnant. And I think that made a big difference.
It would have been harder to get him banished if she just, you know, feared for her own self, which is not the way it should be, but the way it would happen. Mm-hmm. So that made it a really, truly horrendous thing.
Exactly. Yeah. And it wasn't true. And that I noticed that was a theme with Rachel. She would tell these lies when it was convenient for her. Like, okay, her father was, you know, molesting her, which was horrible when she was a child.
Right.
But she never said anything until she was pregnant. And we learned later that she wasn't pregnant with her father's child. She was pregnant with Jamie.
Right.
What the hell?
But see, she was doing it. She thought she was doing it for the greater good, because that way her mother would finally get rid of her husband, who'd been really awful all along.
Mm-hmm. That was a strange twist to me, that, you know, she was actually Jamie's biological mother, and she somehow ends up married to his father without even knowing it.
Well, plus they just took the baby away from her, and they didn't tell her anything about it. Mm-hmm. So, you know, she didn't even know she had a little boy, and she didn't know to start with that Jamie wasn't Nina and David's child. She didn't know that to start with.
Exactly. That was another twist.
Right.
As the mystery with Nina unfolded, including, was she still alive? Because I was questioning that much of the story. Like, they were trying to make it seem as though she was still alive, because Jamie was seeing her. Jamie refused to believe that she was dead. Even Rachel thought she was seeing her on the bus. She thought she saw her in the house. Really weird.
Right.
And I thought to myself, she had better be dead, or it'll be the most predictable thing in the world.
Well, you wanted to think that it was maybe possible, but not likely. And it made more sense that the little boy who'd gone through so much horror and everything, seeing her fall and die, and then thinking he saw her other times, that he'd want to cling to this fiction of her just being missing, not being truly dead.
Right. And she was indeed dead. And that made me, yes, it raised it from like a C+ to a B- for me. Right. Like, okay, because if they had popped up Nina as being alive, I don't think I would have liked that much.
No, I don't think I would have liked that twist in it. And then they finally find her body.
Her body, yeah.
Saying eventually these things come back. Even if they fall down, these things eventually they'll show up again. And that's what happened. It just took a long time for her to be back in some place where she could be found.
Yeah, you know? And David was the first to see her,
right,
her body, and he just left her there.
Oh, what's wrong with that?
He just left it there. And then I think Rachel went out there and she saw it later in the story. And then I think Jamie went out there and saw it too.
Yeah. So, I mean, but so I guess it might have been horrible, but at least he finally understood that, yes,
she was dead.
Really mm-hmm. was gone.
And that poor kid, you know, we were talking in the group about this, but I just think, you know, his father did not do him any favors.
No.
David was not a good dad at all. And I question why he married Rachel. Did he just want a stepmother for his son? Somebody to be there? Because he was never there.
Right.
I didn't understand him.
Well, and Rachel was, you know, young and attractive and all. So, sure, you could always have a nanny or somebody else, but he sure couldn't leave Jamie there with his mother, even though his mother was off in her own area, because the mother was getting worse and worse mm-hmm. about what she thought and all her little dementia problems.
Right.
So I think part of it was because Rachel was so attractive and in a certain way reminded him of Nina, but at the same time it was a good fit because he had somebody he knew would care for Jamie and really love him probably more than he was able to.
Right. In the beginning, when Rachel began to get hints that there was more to Nina's death than David let on, she made a huge deal over the fact that David never mentioned that Nina's body had never been found.
Right.
And I thought that was kind of strange. Like, she overreacted. You know, it's like, okay, what's the big deal? She fell, you know, into the ocean or whatever. I don't know. I just thought it was strange that she immediately suspected that he had nefarious reasons for not telling her that.
Well, and said she, as she said, she'd had problems in the past. So, and I don't think she was still entirely secure about things, especially once she got out in this place by herself. And it was a little bit more creepy being there just with Jamie and the maid and the mother-in-law. So,
yeah, I guess so. And then she started doing all this research, you know, online, researching the death. And I felt like at that point it was going to be like, oh, she's going to get obsessed with the dead wife, you know, and be comparing herself to her. And David's never going to really get over her. But then as a little bit of Nina's activities were revealed, we find that she was actually, she got distant from Jamie for some reason. We didn't know why, but, you know, we learned that she withdrew from him. And then we learn it's because she knew she wasn't his real mother.
Right.
And she was getting jealous of David's relationship with him. But, you know, did David always have this schedule where he was going off to work all week and only coming home on the weekends?
I don't know. I think the main thing it sounded like the reason he did that is because he worked for a company that really paid him the big bucks and keep the family home up. He needed to make a lot of money because they didn't have income coming in from the tin place or anything like that. It was like a lot of these other old estates or that they had both in England and even in the United States that at one time they produced income which kept the place going, but then times changed and you just couldn't afford to keep up that large of a place.
Yeah,
so.
You couldn't live off the land anymore.
No.
Yeah, because it seemed like she was, why she would get jealous of their relationship if he was barely spending time with Jamie anyway.
I know.
So anyway, I don't know about that. And then the other thread that I think was left hanging was Nina's researching into how the family had made their fortune. Mm-hmm. Like that they didn't treat the miners well and they did, it was like really ill-gotten gains. And I thought that was going somewhere, but it didn't seem to go anywhere.
I think it was just sort of background information just to add a little historical perspective into it, because they did have pictures in there that showed real life things that happened in that area.
You know? Yeah, but her looking into it, it was seeming like she was going to do something about it, you know, or make an issue of it or whatever. But I guess that thread was dropped.
Yeah, it's just, I said it just ended up being a little historical perspective into how they made their money and how, like, a lot of times, like these mining places or other type things, agricultural things, they took advantage of the poor people and didn't really care about them just as long as they made money.
Right. Yeah. And then so Rachel's there and she begins to feel lonely and isolated and kind of disconnected from everyone. And I was wondering, wow, she has no one, you know, no friends back home or anything. And David's mother was kind of acting a little bit strange, but then we realize, oh, it's because she does have, you know, she's aging and has dementia and stuff. And Rachel just started feeling there was no one there her own age, no one in the area and stuff. And David is like a decade older than her. And she was uncomfortable telling anyone that this dream life she ran off to marry into wasn't all it was cracked up to be.
Right. Well, and as we said, she was estranged from her mother and her sister, so she couldn't really confide in them because they didn't, you know, really care about her. They'd written her off because she hadn't been loyal in their eyes.
Is that why they wrote her off, though? Because she told about the father?
Right, I think so, because even though they knew it was true, they didn't want that to be the stain on their family. Not that they had some high-level family like David or anything, but that I think a lot of times these, where there's bad situations like that, that even people know things are going on, it, they just want to deny it, because that way it looks less bad for the family, it looks less bad for them, because it looks like they were complicit and they didn't do anything to stop this abuse, even though they knew it was going on.
Right, but I thought it had more to do with her mental state.
Well, that that didn't help any either.
Because that when she spoke to her, so when she called her sister, she wanted to gain some insight into her own problems, her own mind, because she apparently she had no memory of what her behavior had been before when she had the psychosis. So now when she gets pregnant again and it starts happening again, and she can realize that, okay, something's happening to me, right? I'm losing my mind. Then she calls her sister. And the way the sister was talking to her, it seemed more like it was because of her behavior when she was having those problems.
Well, that too. I said, I think it was a combination of things, but mm-hmm. they should have been more supportive because they should have known she was going through a rough patch, but they just weren't there for her, and they still weren't. Because even at the end, when she has the house and the two children and is doing all right, you don't see them trying to come get all cozy with them. You'd think that once she had some money and stuff like that, they'd be like, we can make amends. But
right.
they still had written her off. I don't think she was ever really going to reconcile with them the way things were.
Yeah, and as I mentioned in the group, I would imagine, since we were in Rachel's point of view, we know Rachel has a tendency or propensity to be manipulative.
Right.
So that may have something to do with it as well. Because even though she was victimized, she still has this strain in her. Maybe they don't want anything to do with that.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, she is. And in the long run, it is to survive and to overcome all these other things that have happened to her. And she did okay with the baby. She didn't have any problems with the new baby. So, she had, even though she was all concerned and thought things were going to happen again, she was able to do okay.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I mean, I think it was a combination of things, because family things, a lot of times it's not just any one thing. It's a sort of a culmination of things, the past and the present, everything like that. But yeah, it's a shame though, too, because here she still in this isolated area where there aren't a whole lot of people, period. And then there's just not many people around her age. She still is not in the best situation, but at least, she has two children and is happy with them.
Yeah, but, like I said, she likes to play fast and loose with the truth.
Right.
And that doesn't, endear her to anyone.
Right.
Yeah, and I thought it was, I was pleasantly surprised it had a happy ending.
Yeah.
Because I certainly wasn't expecting that. I thought there was going to be some tragic ending.
Right.
With her dying, because Jamie was saying, you're going to be dead by Christmas. And then every chapter was like, 60 days until Christmas, 72 days until Christmas.
I kept building up to this thing, thinking, something terrible is going to happen.
Exactly.
Yeah, it didn't seem like a happily ever after book. But
no.
But it was to a certain extent.
Well, I was pleasantly surprised. I don't know how believable it is. I mean, this woman is a lunatic when she gets pregnant. I mean,
right. She
completely loses her mind. But fine, it ended happily. I'm good. That's nice. But I still think Jamie's going to need years and years of competent therapy.
Yeah. He's never going to be totally right. He's going to, need
I think he could be if he has a good therapist.
Right, yeah. But on his own, he can't process that much stuff. He needs someone to talk to on a regular basis for a long time.
Yeah, because he's too young. I mean, 7 years old. And I guess he lost his mom at 5.
Yeah, so he's really young.
He's very young. And then his mother grew distant with him when he was 5. And then she suddenly dies, chasing after him. That's the other thing that was mysterious. Like, how did she end up over there? And we find out, it was her chasing after Jamie after all. Because I was suspecting maybe David killed her.
Yeah.
Because of, her digging into his family's past or whatever, But no, he didn't.
No. Yeah. I thought that, all along with him telling Jamie, and telling these other people, we can't tell the sheriff that, that wouldn't be good. So didn't want to, get Jamie included in it. So I kept thinking, well, either he had killed her or driven her to suicide.
Yeah.
That's my thought to start with.
Yeah, but no, poor little 5-year-old Jamie heard that they weren't she wasn't his mother or something. He heard them arguing about it.
Yeah.
And he got upset and ran off, and she went to run after him. And boom, she meets her end.
Right. Yeah. So it was an accident, but then that would be something too, besides seeing his mother, that he'd feel guilty about that forever too.
Exactly. And then to find out, oh no, daddy's next wife is my real mother. But he didn't know it, and she didn't know it. And what the hell?
Like, freaking out.
He's too young to process. I mean, it would be, like I said in the group, it would be too much for a teenager,
right,
to process. So for this little kid, he definitely, and for David to yank him out of therapy, that was just wrong. I know. You didn't like that therapist, find another one, but the kid needs help.
Oh yeah.
Lots to talk about with this book. Lots to talk about. I think it was a good pick.
It was. I'm glad that we were at it.
Me too. I think Mary chose a good one. Okay, so thanks for listening. And that's our discussion of The Fire Child by S.K. Tremayne. Please stay tuned for our next episode, where we will be discussing The Weight of Blood by Laura McHugh. And don't forget to leave us your comments below on The Fire Child. If you've read it, let us know what you think. Bye for now.
Bye.